created a vendor for food. So it was easier to come for a bit of a talk. For me, I think I don't have much to say. It's just that I'm happy that we still find time within our circles to do this type of activities and to commemorate and sometimes internalize and talk about these broad, magnanimous issues. You know, I always keep saying that when you make no reference to this, it's like you don't make no reference to the soul. Because civil society, these types of actors are the soul of the movement, the soul of the Katiba, the soul of many issues. But lately, I think our politics has been so synchronized, you know, that people are more bling with appearance. That's why in Mombasa, people, our adversaries are outdoing us in terms of mirror selfies and, you know, diving underwater and the kind of watch. You never hear major policy pronouncement. All you see is the dress code. Do we love his beard? Do we love his, you know, regalia? But we will never hear policy pronouncement. We call it a synchronization of our politics. And there's a friend who told me he's writing something to do with it. I'm hoping he will do it from a very intellectual, informative basis, so that he can at least inform the soul of our politics too. For me, I just wanted to respond briefly to the gender debate. You know, I sit in the midst of, I'm on this side, I know how we talk about it, and I'm on that side, and I know the contempt about it, you know? And even if you get the vote, it will be a vote of contempt. Yeah, in fact, like right now, I told Winnie Lichuma when I met her on Tuesday in Diani that there will be no quorum to pass your bill, to pass the Sijeni bill. Sijeni always tells members how she will mobilize women to vote them out, and they look at him and I like, if you will be here next election, you'll be like, you know these type of situations. And so what I'm saying is, maybe we need to change strategy. That's why, I mean, for me, I would want an internalization by civil society in terms of repositioning our strategy. Time and again, strategies must evolve. You know, when I look at the women activism debate, these issues, sometimes you're they're on the high table there, and you have this galaxy of men considered with power and wealth listening to you, and they think you're just in an argument. They look at you like, what is she talking about? We are the owners of the party. We are the ones who nominated her. Even these decisions, once we get the vote, that one third, it is the men who make the decisions. They know that. Who gets into those lists? That's why there's been this massive debate about how do we get people onto these lists. So I think what you need to do is to attack some of these questions from a political dimension. You know, I've found myself either coincidentally, accidentally, or deliberately in politics, and I realize half the time, you have to state yourself almost at a point of threat, but you have to first galvanize a real political constituency, an ability to cause sufficient nuisance. Yeah, that you know, you went to a point where you say, if I don't get it, also you guys will not get it. Mm-hmm. That if you guys think you have no, if you think you have one, you are the ones with one bullet. I have so many. You know what I mean? I can keep testing whether they still kill. You know. So this type of situations, unless you build a certain political base and constituency, it becomes very difficult for us people with great ideas to constantly be trying to plead with people who have no idea at all. Because, you know, it's not even that people have basic idea there. And I don't know what happens. Most of us, when we get into those bunges, you also sometimes tend to argue or stand with the majority. But I think for me, the gender issue is the manner in which it was canvassed. Yeah, it has been canvassed. I think I needed some good players like Tom Kagwe, Kepta, Davinda. I think you should have helped structure a campaign. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that tends also sometimes to appeal to the soft underbelly of the political class. I'm not saying that you need to please them, but politics is politics. Mm-hmm. You know, like right now when I even map out my constituency of how I need to be either re-elected as Mombasa governor or win the Mombasa governor. Not a re-elected a senator, win Mombasa governor. You have different tiers of what you call this, demographics. Mm-hmm. There are those who are the converted, and I expect them to be, you know, you don't even, I've gone to places, they're like, it's an insult for you to talk to us, to support you. We almost have an obligation to do it collectively. And there are those people of your type who I can come and present an agenda, and you will, it will carry. Then there are those from the Steve Ouma backyard, who as long as you look orange, no matter what you do, for as long as you've shown that your love for Baba, your love for Baba is beyond any, you know, casual imagination. Wow. You know, you will be buried in a orange casket. The minute you prove that,
yes.
You know, whether he's from the intelligentsia or from the peasants, they will just vote for you. You know, they don't look at the quality. And I'm not saying all of them. But there's so many demographics. Then there are those you're told, you know, for me, my trauma is, there's that demographic that is moved by money. You're aware these things will happen, as much as they have been outlawed. So you have like a tier of demographics that you need to deal with. So there's a way in which politicians sometimes might want to get to them in a manner that in your own assessment might look petty, but for them makes them look important. That's the worst, unfortunate bit about it. You know, I've gone to a place and I don't know if I came in the stricter sense of protocol, I needed to sit here. So that you, three of you are mine, you, so that shows them in the middle, I'm the important guy. You know, so if you take a politician who's, and put him at the very end of a queue next to Mugambi Kiai, who just works for himself during the day, you know, then you wonder what kind of protocol, because my protocol officers by now, because they do have these things, will have been up in arms, because a lot of, even senators, some of them do have protocol officers. When you hear that protocol officer, he's just going to make sure that his chair is at the right place, and he will inform you now, he's coming. So Sema, Moja! You know, so just so that you raise the excitement as he comes in. And unfortunately, it's important for them. It might not be important for you, you might think, what the heck is going on, but unfortunately they've been socialized that way. You Kenyans, or we Kenyans, have spoiled politicians so much. You know, if somebody who casually thinks he just needs to jump every queue that there is, And some of the, even the times when some are reluctant to jump, and ask Mheshimiwa Peter, as in Mheshimiwa come in, and you'll be told how this is a position you have been given by God. It's God who chooses our leaders. Like, I don't believe God chooses Kenyan leaders, personally, because God cannot make these types of decisions. So this type of situation is important. So what you need to do also is to reach out to constituencies. There are constituencies even within this parliament that are not beyond repair totally. Some of them might have shot themselves in the foot come the next election. They went and tried to challenge Baba, but still, for now, they still are in parliament until that time when election comes. And they're very, very important. They're very significant in terms of rallying the women agenda. But the last one. We cannot have serial nominees. One nomination and that is enough. And we told Sijeni repeatedly, that was the condition given by most of the persons, that you, in fact, they were even told that you people who were already nominated, don't sit in court in your own nomination. In other words, be dispassionate about this women agenda, provide for one, and those of you who have served at this time, you will be celebrated when you're in your own space having won, having at least seen through this bill. Number two, there's a sunset, and that is good, because you cannot be affirmed indefinitely. Mm-hmm. I was affirmed once as a youth. I cannot now evolve to say now you've forgotten me as a marginalized. The next thing I imagine as a Muslim, and as I'm getting towards the Binder's age, I say elderly. You know, you can't be constantly changing in terms of the constituencies of minorities. So that is another one. And then another one also, like every good idea, there's also a side effect. I had one Mzee saying this in the Senate, and I cracked my ribs with laughter, but it was a bad statement nonetheless. I will make it here because we are discussing. He says, tupatie hii watu viti yao, alafu wakija kutafuta hiyo nyingine yote ya kuchagua, tutawaambia mnafanya nini na tumewapatia yenu. That you try to run for governor, utaambia, what are you doing? Tumekupatia tayari yako, uko umekuwa nominated. Uko na ile ya 47. Uko na, sasa alafu bado pia unatafuta hiyo wazee. You know that? So also prepare yourself in terms of what you call political education or public education. Because I can tell you, in societies where there's patriarchy, like the ones where wazirs can recall you even before the end of your term, you can be sure that you have no chance for those wazirs to sit down and make, they will just say, tuko na nomination tatu, and that's where we leave it at. So you also have to look at the side effects. But I can tell you, on the majority, this agenda is supported. But unfortunately, the majority is not two-thirds. You see, the majority of us support it. In fact, one of the reasons we decided we are still going to vote for it, despite the fact that we said a nomination is only in one term, is because all of us who are supporting it also know that we are decision makers in our parties. So we said we can fix that in the parties, so that every party can create it as a policy document that does not nominate somebody more than once. So we can fix it there, so rather than defeat an entire bill. But also we are asking, because we've been advised, rightly or wrongly, that we cannot amend a constitutional bill. But if there is a chance for amendment, it will be amended. And I'm hoping this time, if it goes through the Senate, because what we decided to do, tactfully, but in a moot comment, is to appoint a date that there is no other business apart from that bill. So you either come, so we see you vote, or you don't come. And then we finalize, we go to committee of the whole, we go through that reading. That whole thing is done in one afternoon, but it's very basic. So it's very easy to do it. So that quorum that is mobilized is there in terms of the 45 to see through the entire process. And that, at that point now, you are able to take a roll call of who is there, who is not. These things do have the name and shame. Then because at least some of us who come from broader constituencies, you know, all constituencies, urban constituencies where there are no wazirs that are not determined by one ethnic group, that don't have one baba and one mama, at least you have to also appeal to these constituencies in your own unique way. So it makes good political sense to do that. But as we go on, you know, it is difficult to always imagine the women debate as tokenism. That's what it appears like. That it is the good nature of Raila Odinga and Uhuru Kenyatta and et al. For them to appear to, even where a woman is appointed in her own merit, at KPA, MD, it is celebrated. And I'm like, okay. It continues to perpetuate that these are being done based on a certain structure of favoritism. What were Tanzania, you know what nominations are called? Vitu vya mapendeleo. Vile vitu vya mapendeleo vile. So you cannot, I don't know, after that we need to reposition our conversation. So that, I know that's why for me, sometimes I try not to talk too much about youth, so that you don't think you're voting for me because I'm a youth, but it's probably the things I articulate. Or constantly appear to appeal and say, you know, now you have to assist me because me, I come from the coast, I come a Muslim and all that. That's why I've been trying also to fight that idea of a regional consciousness crystallizing, because it only feeds into a narrative that negates ideas. You know, like one of our friends, when he was told he cannot give back his gun, then he came and said, now I need to be president, you know. So we don't know his ideas, and now what he's trying to do is to cement a regional or ferment a regional consciousness. And I, you know, that's one of the times I went a little hard on Raila. And when he asked me what's going on, I said, we can't have what you have in Nyanza and Coast Region. You know, it's scary that you're trying to institutionalize a regional consciousness through people who represent very little, you know, at a very different time of our lives. If I have to go through a gatekeeper or a regional player, where would that take me? Where would that take people who come up with brilliant ideas? So we don't want that type of thing. But still, we've audited that constitution and everything at the national level. None of you is doing anything about counties. That's where the biggest problem is. We don't cheat you. You know, this national level is the usual dynamic. We don't, you know, you cannot expect Uhuru Kenyatta, when you plant bananas, you can't expect to reap oranges. You know, most of you here are getting disappointed because you went and voted Uhuru Kenyatta based on whatever consciousness, and then now you expect so much from him. For me, one of the reasons I don't get disappointed from Uhuru is because I expected very little. So the less you expect, the less the disappointment. That's why I wake up every day and I do my thing. And I'm like, this guy expected Uhuru to deliver on the constitution. How could he have expected Uhuru to deliver on the constitution? You know, things like that. But at the county level, there's hardly any audit. Governors are told to be units of social justice, social service delivery. They are busy putting up capital everywhere and launching toilets and water points. And the narrative from Northern Kenya, you know, the most idiotic, ati kwanzia Uhuru kwa hatuna barabara lami, sasa tumewekea 2 kilometers. But those guys, their priority was not to 2 kilometers of lami, but again, it was something totally different. And you think it's okay, and that's why we go as called Raila, revolution is doing well. You know, you have patronized devolution to these little things. So you see, and then, so that's how we counter them, that now there are small things happening around you. God bless you.